Welcome one and all. Now we will give you demonstration for class 2 cavity preparation on mandibular second molar, the tooth. You should know all the armamentarium which are required, and you should have all of them before starting the cavity preparation. You should have all four types of burr, that is round, inverted cone, tapered and straight fissure. Then you should have all the instrument, all diagnostic set, carving and plastic instruments. Now we'll start with the cavity preparation for mandibular second molar, that is class 2 cavity preparation. First you should start with the help of round burr, and you should keep round burr parallel to the long axis of tooth, and it should be placed in the central pit. You should remember all the steps in cavity preparation, that is fundamentals of cavity preparation, which are divided into initial and final steps. We will achieve initial depth, which is around 0.2 mm into the dentine, which is achieved with the help of round burr. Now this debris can be removed with the help of chip blower. After gaining initial depth, you will change burr from round burr to straight fissure burr, and you should move straight fissure burr along the central fissure, that is mesially and distally, and after that buccally as well as lingually, so as to extend into the fissures, buccal and lingual fissure. Now again one more point which you should remember, that is what is will be the depth of cavity. Now you should know that the working end of straight fissure burr is around 3 mm in length, so your cavity should be around half of the straight fissure burr. So you will achieve around 1.5 mm of depth from the central fissure. This is rough depth of the cavity. Now I will start extending the cavity mesially as well as distally along the central fissure. So while extending the cavity, you should remember that you should not hamper the strength of marginal ridge distally, because we are not going to extend the cavity distally, that is class 2 preparation, we are going to prepare mesially. So you have to preserve marginal ridge distally. So the thickness of marginal ridge will be around 1.5 mm, so as to give strength to the tooth. Again one more point which you should remember while preparing cavity, that you should place the tooth or the jaw on a stable position, and then you should use your ring finger as a rest and you should prepare the cavity. Now we have achieved initial depth of around 1.5 mm from the central fissure. We have extended distally and we have prepared dovetail such that the marginal ridge is preserved and the thickness of marginal ridge is around 1.5 mm. Now after distal extension you have to extend mesially as well. Mesially we have not prepared dovetail because we have to prepare proximal box on the mesial side. So for preparing proximal box, before preparing proximal box we have to place a matrix band between the two teeth so as to prevent the adjacent tooth from cutting. After placement of matrix band, we have to start preparing proximal box with the help of straight fissure burr, and we have to place gingival floor at a depth such that it is below the contact point. And one more thing we have to keep in mind, that for we have to prepare the buccal and lingual walls of proximal box such that it has break the contact point and there is about 0.5 mm of gap between the adjacent two. This is how we place. Now we have placed a band between the two teeth, that is between 6 and 7, so as to prevent cutting of adjacent tooth, that is 6. We will place straight fissure burr just in the mesial half of proximal box along the parallel to the long axis of tooth, and we will start preparing the proximal box. At this point, the buccal and the lingual wall of proximal box are straight, they are not occlusally convergent. Secondly, the gingival floor is at the level of contact point only. So we have to go cervically so that the gingival floor is not in contact with adjacent tooth and it is below the contact point. You have to make buccal and lingual wall occlusally convergent in the proximal box. So you have to angulate for preparing lingual wall occlusally convergent in the proximal box. You have to angulate and tapered fissure burr, buccal wall of proximal box occlusally convergent. You have to angulate buccally so that your wall is occlusally convergent. So now first we will make our gingival floor cervically so that it is not in contact with adjacent tooth and it is below the contact point. So we will do this with the help of straight fissure burr, keeping for making buccal and lingual wall occlusally convergent, we have changed the burr from straight fissure to tapered fissure. We will angulate the burr so as to make occlusally convergent wall. This was for lingual wall. Now we will angulate for buccal wall as well. Remove excess debris. The proximal box is now prepared completely. The walls that are buccal and lingual walls are occlusally convergent. Your axial wall is convex, which simulates the external tooth surface. Then your gingival floor is placed below the contact point. And now we will do finishing of occlusal pulpal floor so that It's completely smooth with no hindrance while moving the probe. We have to place inverted cone burr parallel to long axis of tooth so that and we have to finish pulpal floor. We have to move inverted cone along the walls. We have to do final finishing of proximal box also, so with the help of inverted cone burr we can finish gingival floor. We have to keep in mind that it should not touch at this change tooth. The burr from inverted cone to tapered fissure. We have to move along the walls in the proximal box as well as on the occlusal surface. With the help of straight probe, now check whether there are any hindrances while moving the probe, both occlusally as well as pulpally, proximally. Now there are no hindrances. Now your cavity is being prepared for as a class 2 cavity preparation, that is mesio occlusal preparation with mandibular right second molar. Then we have to use zinc phosphate cement as a base, which acts as a purity material. Powder and a liquid. We have to divide powder into small increment and a large increment. So while mixing, first we have to take small increments and followed by that larger increments. The powder liquid ratio for mixing zinc phosphate cement is about 0.5:1. So we will first mix smaller increment into the liquid and we have to mix in a circular motion and into larger surface area as it is an exothermic type of reaction. After achieving dove stage, you have to place the cement, zinc phosphate cement, onto the cavity and the proximal box. You have to dip instrument into the spirit or powder so that the cement does not stick onto the instrument. Condense it on the axial wall so that it is properly coated onto the axial wall. Remove excess with the help of spoon excavator from the occlusal surface. With the help of plastic instrument, condense it onto the axial wall. Mix this with the help of spoon excavator and then final finishing is done with the help of burr. Thank you. With the help of inverted cone burr, smoothen the pulpal floor on from occlusal surface, and in the axial surface you can use straight fissure burr. And from if excess is present on the buccal and lingual walls as well as in the proximal box walls, you can remove with the help of spoon excavator and burr. We have changed burr from inverted cone to tapered fissure now. This tapered fissure can be used in the proximal box so as to make axial wall smooth. Now the axial wall is properly finished. One more point which you should remember by preparing smoothing the axial wall is that your axiopulpal line angle should not be pointed, it should be rounded. You can round off the axiopulpal line angle with the help of tapered fissure burr. So now you have rounded axiopulpal line angle, which you should remember is that the zinc phosphate cement should not be placed on the gingival floor as well as on the buccal and lingual wall of proximal box. If it is present, you should remove with the help of burr or spoon excavator. After placement of base, we have to apply a matrix band, retainer and wedge. So we have to select a matrix band. There are different sizes available in matrix band also. So you have to select a size such that the height of matrix band is 1 mm above the occlusal surface. It should not be more than 1 mm. One matrix band and retainer. This matrix band has a convex gingival portion which is to be placed gingivally and a straight occlusal portion. This part will be at the occlusal end and this will be at the gingival end. The next part, that is how should be retainer placed. This is the retainer, number one retainer. Whenever you are showing a class 2 cavity preparation base, you have to place matrix band, retainer and a wedge. These wedges are also available in different sizes, so accordingly you have to select and place a wedge. Wedge can be placed either buccally as well as lingually. It has the pointed portion, you should insert it in a gingival embrasure either buccally as well as lingually. This wedge will help in matrix band further, which will contour the restoration. There are two techniques for placement of matrix band and retainer. The first one, which you can place first matrix band in between the two teeth, followed by placement of retainer. Okay. The other technique will be you can just place retainer in the hole and then according to the size of the tooth and then place it onto the tooth structure. So I will show you both the techniques. First, we will place the band, contour it along the tooth. This is one type of placement of matrix band and retainer. You have to tighten it. And the prongs of this retainer should be in the gingival embrasure. Now we have to place a wedge. So we have to place wedge interdentally between both the teeth and it should 15 the mandatory span. So now we have placed matrix band, retainer and the wedge. Now this is ready for restoration, amalgam restoration. You should check if there is any gap between the gingival floor and the band. If there is any gap, then you might have to place one more wedge in between. After completion of base, we have to move on to amalgam restoration. So armamentariums required for amalgam restoration are shown. First, mortar and pestle, then mercury, tapping dish and gauze for squeezing. The steps for making amalgam as a restorative material are, for first and foremost, you should take proper ratio, followed by that trituration, then squeezing of excess mercury, then mulling with the help of cloth or with the help of gloves, then place of the amalgam on the opposite end of tapping dish, that followed by amalgam from tapping dish to cavity with the help of amalgam carrier. So we take powder and mercury about in a ratio of about 1:1. That is also known as Ames technique. While trituration, you have to keep two things in mind. First and foremost, the grass pestle we have to use in a thumb and palm grass, and we have to move the pestle along the walls of mortar so that silver particles get coated with the mercury. One more thing which you have to keep in mind, that while trituration, you have to keep mortar on a stable surface, that is on the table. Ensuring that the silver particles are coated completely with the mercury, then you have to take the mixed part onto the gauze piece and squeeze it. With this process, you remove excess mercury from the amalgam. The excess mercury should be collected from the mortar. After complete squeezing, you have to take the material onto the gloves and do mulling. Index finger and palm. This is how the material looks after complete mulling. After mulling, you have to transfer this amalgam onto the tapping dish. With the help of amalgam carrier, you have to carry amalgam from the tapping dish to the cavity surface with an increment portion. We have to, after placing one first increment, you have to condense with the help of round and parallelogram condenser. After condensing this increment properly, then we have to move on to the second increment and condense it. After complete mixing of amalgam, that is trituration, we have to place carry amalgam from tapping dish to onto for the proximal box first. We have to place an increment of amalgam in the proximal box first. Then we have to condense it with the help of condenser. Then start condensing the amalgam on the occlusal surface. again take small increment of amalgam with the help of amalgam carrier and place onto the aqueous surface. Condense it properly with the help of parallel round cylindrical condenser. Condense amalgam slightly in excess. Remove excess with the help of spoon excavator. Both from the occlusal as well as from the proximal marginal ridge area and the mesial side. Then we have to start carving with the help of three carvers. Just before starting the carving, we have to check for the initial set of amalgam restoration, which can be checked with the help of clicking sound when you move carver along the cusp. So first we have to remove excess with the help of spoon excavator from all over the surface, opposite surface. We have to remove excess with the help of spoon excavator, for then followed by carving, which can be done with the help of three carvers, that is, they are Hollenbach, Watts and Franz or Diamond carver, any carver you can use. For carving, you have to keep remember many things which are important. First and foremost, we should remember that while carving, half of the instrument should be placed onto the tool structure and half on the restoration. Then you have to move the carver along the cusped tip. You have to place carver such that it is in the center of the tool. As there is no proximal box distally, we are preparing medial occlusal cavity preparation. So you have to prepare a triangular fossa in the distal triangular fossa, which can be done with the help of carver. So by bifurcating central groove into two halves with the distal marginal ridge. This is how you carve triangular fossa. Coming on to mesial side, where there is a marginal, you have to carve marginal ridge, triangular fossa. And the restoration. Just wipe it with a cotton pellet so that there are no remnants of amalgam onto the carved surface. You have to carve marginal ridge in the mesial half, so you have to move an instrument from buckle to removal direction. With this, you will carve marginal ridge. You can use diamond carver for carving a triangular fossa easily as well as easily. So after completion of carving, you have to remove wedge with the help of tweezer. Followed by that, we have to first remove retainer, placing band there only onto the tool surface. Now for the removal of the band, first you have to remove the band buccally lingually slowly, and you have to lift band occlusally. With this you will polish the proximal surface restoration. Now you just have to check whether the marginal ridge is above the occlusal level, about the adjacent tooth, and to carve along the buccal and the lingual surface. Completion of carving, you have to just move a small cotter pellet on the surface of restoration so as to remove small debris, particles of amalgam from the restorative surface. This is how the restoration looks after complete carving. After completion of carving, you have to move small cotter pellet on the restoration surface so as to remove remnants of amalgam restoration from the surface. This is how restoration looks after the final carving. So this is the central groove. These are buccal, lingual and buccal fissures. This is distal triangular fossa which is carved. This is a marginal ridge and mesial triangular fossa. You have to keep in mind that the marginal ridge should not be higher when the instrument is moved from lingual to buccal or buccal to lingual, as well as from the adjacent tooth marginal ridge. Not have then any overhanging restoration from the. These are the two most important points which you should remember when you are doing the restoration and when you check for the final